Welcome to the latest, as a matter of fact, the last episode for this year of our podcast and YouTube video channel. Today's guest is the distinguished Minister of Foreign Affairs and Trade, Péter Szijjártó, whom we know each other for quite a long time, I can tell. As a matter of fact, we had a couple of years working together on communications issues dating back to 2010 and before. But today we are not going to talk about these elements. Very obviously, communications is going to be very important, but...
Although we could tell very important and interesting stories, right?
Very well, and probably time is going to come for that.
Yeah, hopefully.
But today's intent is the same as you witnessed last time, and that is try to summarize the challenges foreign policy in Hungary met this year. To be able to talk about that, let's reach back to 2014. As a matter of fact, that was the year when you were appointed Foreign Minister and Trade. And I recall that there was only one request coming from the Prime Minister, and that was run Hungarian foreign policy proper. What does that mean, and how do you see the 8 years behind you, the foreign ministry, and the country from that perspective?
Well, that was definitely not a long conversation when we spoke about the goals and the duties when I had the honor to take this office, but I think no longer conversation is needed if the substance of that long conversation can be summarized in such a short sentence. Run Hungarian foreign policy, and I think that all the events and developments, which we definitely have not quite foreseen back in 2014, what followed 2014, make this sentence even more important and more significant, because most of the developments which took place after September 2014 have been heavily jeopardizing the sovereignty of the given countries and nations. And these challenges which we had to go through required a very strong stance on behalf of countries which are proud of their thousand year long history, heritage, culture, religion, and we don't want to give those up. So back in 2014, when this sentence was said, we have not thought that we would have been faced with so many tremendous challenges related to security, health, or even energy. And, in this ministry, we have made huge changes. To be honest, in the first half a year, we were surviving day by day. And sometimes walking on the corridor, I had to turn around quite often in order to see those coming after me with knives. But after a while, it became very obvious that the old type of foreign policy is no longer valid or maintainable, given the fact that the whole world has changed a lot. Speed quick reaction, combining economic interests with foreign policy, making foreign policy to serve economic interests, sticking to sovereignty. These phenomena became maybe the most important driving factors in foreign policy. And that's why I have never judged those who have run the foreign policy before me, because simply the circumstances were different. A different approach was needed. But now the old approach is not applicable anymore. Not because it was wrong, those were different circumstances.
Not as if the circumstances starting in 2010 were, calm and peaceful, because Hungary, right from the moment actually the conservative, the national government took office, bumped into issues, topics, if you like, which, as you put, the sovereignty stance obviously required to represent and maintain. But at the same time, many suggested that with the coming of Prime Minister Orbán, and also your foreign minister status, Hungary became more confrontational. I myself don't believe so. I don't know the reasons, but I believe that confrontation, and that is creating a contrast in foreign policy and in ideas we are pursuing and we are commencing is necessary among the circumstances we witness. This is probably the most disturbed and complicated international scene we've seen for long, long decades behind us since the fall of communism, and that is the end of the Cold War.
Yeah, I agree with you. The fact is that that the international political life is being overruled and influenced by a very strong international mainstream, which can be characterized as extremist liberal. This is the mainstream now. Now, definitely, since 2010, we have a government in Hungary which goes against the mainstream, which does not represent the mainstream, which is patriotic, which is right-wing, which considers the Christian approach very important. And this definitely, or these phenomena definitely do not fall in line with anything which can be characterized as mainstream. And I think that the conflict has to be looked for in this very basic level. And what you see on top of it, it's more tactical than that. So, but everything originates from this. When it comes to conflicts, you know, I think there are two types of political conflicts, two types of political conflicts or confrontations. Let's say the constructive kind of confrontations and the harmful ones or destructive confrontations. And when it comes to the constructive ones, I have no problem with those because, debate is the basis for democracy. So it's always really frustrating to listen to those who usually judge and criticize us because of not being a democracy. But on another level, when we try to debate, then they challenge our right to debate. And I think it's a very anti-democratic approach. We have never judged or criticized anyone just for having a different type of position than us, because it's natural. I mean, many times within the family you don't agree on everything. In international politics it's obvious that countries cannot agree on everything. But challenging the rights of others to take part in the debates and to represent their own position according to their own national interest, that's too much. And what is really missing from international politics now, I think, is mutual respect. Because if you look at those debates which you have been involved in, those debates have never been or very rarely been, based on facts and on factual confrontations or common sense realistic approach. These debates have always been ideologized and politicized basically immediately, and those were based on perceptions. And having a debate based on perceptions is that will not lead you anywhere. So that's why I think we do have to stick to our right to carry out these debates on a fact-based basis, which is not easy, and this definitely goes against the interest of the liberal mainstream.
You, of course, are also a communications guy, as they say.
Used to be.
You know that perceptions also come with a narrative.
Yeah.
And the most astonishing thing about Hungary and the past 12 years behind us is probably the development of a completely biased, unjustified, non-factual, as a matter of fact, fictional narrative about Hungary. We can mention lots of elements and episodes of that actually for the past 12 years, but certainly the latest, the past couple of weeks and months behind us mean a new peak for that. Just to mention to you one element, 2, maybe 3 days ago, when a German European Parliament member, Mr. Freund, has criticized us. Criticized us for having a negotiation, just a negotiation about gas with Qatar, just in the midst of the ongoing corruption scandal in the European Parliament. As a matter of fact, in face of the fact that just 3, maybe 4 weeks before, Germany has signed a 15 years long contract with Qatar, supplying billions and billions of cubic meters of gas. How can we cope with this? I mean, this is obviously a communications challenge for political communications, and that is in a hostile environment and against a hostile narrative. You have to develop your own, which we believe and we maintain should be factual and fact-based, and obviously closer to reality from the perspective of how to conduct it and how to manage it. What can we make of this, and how can we cope with it, with a special regard to the war in Ukraine?
Look, I remember when we worked together and I was a spokesman for the Prime Minister, and back in 2010, these attacks have already been launched against us, you might remember. Then, you know, when the first article, first report came out that someone said something unfair against us, we worked like half an hour, in order to react and in order to put the, let's say, the counter argument there. But when we finished with that, I had the report of five another attacks. So I tried to cope up with them, but when we finished with them, it was obvious that there was a pile of like 10 attacks. And so after a while, you have to understand that if you react one by one, it's going to eat up your life, your time, your capacities, your efforts, your nerves, whatever. So I think what is a good counter narrative and the counter reaction is success. Because I do believe that what this liberal mainstream cannot digest is the fact that with our existence, our presence, we prove that it is not only the progressive liberal way to go forward, and on top of that, we are successful. So having a patriotic, right-wing, Christian democratic, anti-mainstream, not progressive government in place for 12 and a half years and being successful, this is totally undigestible. For the liberal mainstream. That's why I say that that our best narrative is our success. Because as long as we break the all-time investment records year by year, as long as the companies from those countries where we have a very bad political context are investing here billions of euros on an annual basis, we are on the safe side. Why? Because those people who make the real decisions and those people who have real responsibility to shareholders and, you know, to workers, to employees, those people always make their judgment, their decision based on facts and not what the Süddeutsche Zeitung or Frankfurter Allgemeine or whatever Le Monde writes about us. And that's why I think that our strongest argument in this narrative is the pure reality. And you see, in the high school, when I studied Latin, we were taught the saying, quod licet Jovi, non licet Bovi. Everybody knows what's the meaning of this. And sometimes the big countries, representatives of big countries, think that they can apply this approach in international politics. But at the end of the day, it turns out it's not right. And another important element, what I'd like to add here, you refer to the war. Now this war has strengthened a very strong anti-China stance in Europe as well, as a byproduct, let's put it this way. But you know, anytime we discuss this issue with foreign ministers who are, you know, very furious about China's presence in Europe. They want to, you know, just cut the relationships and say that we have to push China out, all this kind of very smart stuff. I keep on telling them that the CEOs of the biggest German companies usually call me and ask me to give offers for incentives for their Chinese suppliers to put up investments in Hungary, possibly very close to their own factories, because the supply from China is so important from the perspective of the outcome of the German companies. So whoever speaks about, you know, the need for cutting relationships with other parts of the world and Europe, don't know what would be the very serious impact of this. And I think that our success can be measured also in a way that our reputation outside of Europe is very strong. And our position outside of Europe when it comes to economic and political terms is very strong outside of Europe. And we should not fall into a mistake that we would think that there's no world outside of Europe or there's no world outside of the transatlantic area, you know. So I think the successes and the results of ours have certified so far that what we have been doing is successful, is good. We have to keep up doing that, regardless of the fact that Mr. Freund and other very smart and useful persons make stupid statements on a very continuous basis.
You already mentioned the, let's call it liberal mainstream or woke, actually, that is trying to, in narratives and in claims, and as a matter of fact, in proper foreign political incentives, to overshadow reality. And we all know that for you, right from the beginning of your appointment, trade, and that is the external economic relations of Hungary, was a priority. Again, facts are going to tell the viewer and the listener. We are going to provide some statistical data on that in the background. That for the past 5-6 years, year by year, it's a record high FDI, and that is foreign investment, export surplus year behind us. Still, these realities and these results are being overshadowed by the war in Ukraine, not simply because of the war, but because of the effects and side effects, and that is skyrocketing energy prices, and the very fact that Hungary's model, like Europe's model, was much dependent on access to cheap energy coming from the east, and that is from Russia and the eastern part of Europe and Eurasia. Is there a need to reconsider, and that is to have a new strategy, a paradigm change, if you like? How are we going to proceed with this? There were lots of investments still in the making, making Hungary in car manufacturing, in car battery and other industries a European leader. Is there a need for a change, or it's only adjustment to the realities?
Look, I think we have made it very wisely that we have never discriminated among investors in Hungary. We have always had only one requirement towards those who came here to invest, which is to respect our rules and regulations. And of course, I heard, you know, many criticism because of that, you know, Chinese investors, but whenever we compete for a Chinese state-of-the-art investment, there are always European competitors to that. You might remember me, I think that was the best story when Huawei was under heavy attack, and we were under heavy attack while Huawei is present in Hungary. You know, when we handed over the 5G system in downtown, operated by Vodafone, which is not a Eastern company, let's put it this way, Vodafone, and I asked their CEO, so who has made the infrastructure for that? And she said, well, Huawei, of course, you know. So we should not be hypocritical in this regard, and Europe is very hypocritical when it comes to these kind of issues that on the surface and above the surface, in order to satisfy the liberal media, liberal NGOs, their financiers, they hit China, they hit the Western world, but then under the surface they do their best in order to attract investments, in order to make money on the relationship, and so on and so forth. So I think that this policy or political strategy of ours to be open towards the eastern part of the world as well has to be maintained, no question. Especially putting into consideration that the biggest ever investment in the history of ours, which is now starting, is a Chinese one. The second biggest one is a Korean one. Third biggest one is a German one. So we are diversified, I think, enough. And if we give up on our cooperation with the eastern part of the world, we lose a lot. We lose jobs, we lose opportunities, we lose growth potential, and at the end of the day, it's going to be people who lose. And this is something that we must not afford. Although you're right, the comfortable phenomenon of a competitive European economy based on a combination of developed Western technology and easily accessible Eastern sources of energy, that's over.
I don't like to interrupt you, but recall that we basically announced that by the mid-decade, we've closed the period of cheap labor and wanted to invest in high value added novel industries. We succeeded in that. Very obviously, that was the closure of one model and one period, but it's a very short period behind us, when we had a cheap energy accessible.
Yeah, you're totally right, as the world is not normal from the perspective of economic operation, because it has never appeared before that within 3 years, two big crises, put the Europe, put the global economy basically top down. So I mean, you know, the pandemic and other war. So, but you're right. So the era of cheap, let's say, Russian gas in Europe is over, definitely, because the ties between Russia and Europe, or the European Union, is now being cut, you know, one by one, and I'm not quite sure it can be cured or healed during our lifetime. What I think is important to make it very clear that that the energy issues are neither political nor ideological issues, but physical ones. Because with political ideas or ideologies or statements, you cannot heat, you cannot, you know, boil up the water. You need gas for that. So it's a physical issue. And it's obvious that, physically speaking, the safe supply of energy in Hungary cannot be guaranteed without using Russian sources. This is a fact. This is a physical fact. This is not a matter of political taste. And I think we must not allow anybody to put pressure on us to to put the safe supply of the country at risk. We have always been able to maintain a pragmatic relationship with the Russians, which allows us to tell them honestly what we think about the situation. And then we usually tell them that we condemn the war. This war causes a lot of harm to us, a lot of difficulties to us, to Europe. By the way, the sanctions cause a lot of difficulties and harms to us as well. So the best solution would be to stop this war and sit to the negotiations table, but without dialogue, without having the communication channels open, that's not going to be possible. That's I think, very, very obvious.
If two consecutive crises, then the ongoing war was not enough. Here we go with the global minimum tax. And here we go, when we have this discussion, we still don't know how the Poles are going to sort out the differences, because in face of the agreement that was reached by the evening of Monday, this is a Thursday we speak, and there's an ongoing European summit, it is still an open question what's going to happen with the global minimum tax. Can you clarify and be a little bit specific on the Hungarian stance, what the Poles think about it, and what the way out would be? Many feel that the global minimum tax itself is just another element which is not going to help Europe's competitiveness in the world.
I'm pretty sure it's not going to help the European competitiveness. It's not going to help the competitiveness of the global economy either. Back in 2010, when we took over the office, there was a high unemployment, a high state debt, high tax rates, progressive tax system. Now, as we are speaking about a really successful Hungarian economy, there are low tax rates, flat tax, record high employment, record high growth, record high exports, and record investment. So I think the recipe is obvious. The flat tax and the fact that the lowest tax rates of Europe has to be paid in Europe brought huge success to Hungary. And the reason why we kept on going against the global minimum tax was that we did not want to come back to the situation like in 2010, when jobs of the Hungarian people are at risk. And the reason why we negotiated for so long was that we needed a guarantee that, given the fact that there is local tax in force in Hungary, we can calculate the local tax when we calculate the tax level in Hungary. As long as we have not received this guarantee, we were not ready to align ourselves with the idea of global minimum tax. Why we were able to agree on Monday was that we have received a written guarantee that we can calculate the local tax when it comes to the global minimum tax calculation, which means that we could agree without being forced to increase taxes, and we can agree with the global minimum tax without jeopardizing jobs of Hungarians. If we had not received this kind of guarantee, we would have never would have never given our consent to the global minimum tax. But this way, it doesn't disturb us because there will be no Hungarian jobs at risk because of this. The Polish, I understand, are still looking into the matter. I think with a good reason, because I mean, no one likes this idea. We don't like this idea either. But I mean, if it doesn't harm us, why shouldn't we let the others do what they want?
Where is the guarantee that others, namely the US and the other parts of the globe, are going to introduce the same attitude, or rather effectively the same level of taxation?
There's no guarantee for that at all, of course. I mean, you just have to look at how the US has been dealing with the current economic challenge. They have been applying this IRA, which is the Inflation Reduction Act, in the framework of which they mobilize enormous amount of money to support their national economy on an absolutely selective basis, meaning that they only support American companies in this regard, which I think is an understandable position. So I would not attack or criticize them for this, because I mean, we like the patriotic approach, right? What we don't like is that if we do apply the patriotic approach, we are immediately under attack. Why we are doing that? And you know, very recently we had a meeting with the ministers of External Economic Relations and Trade in the European Union, where the vice president of the European Commission said that, well, they would discuss with the Americans how to step back from this. And I asked the man, I mean, I asked the vice president, do you consider it really seriously? Do you see in front of you the scene that President Biden stands there and says, or whoever from American administration, oh, sorry, because of the request of the Europeans, we step back and we don't support that much the American industry, or we support, come on. I mean, we should learn from the Americans, no doubt, and we should do the same. We should do the same. For example, we should eliminate, or European Commission should eliminate, the artificial limit of incentivizing investments in our countries using our own budget resources. So instead of, you know, going for dreams, we should leave the reality. So my position is that that there's no guarantee for the other regions to introduce this tax, but we really have to look at what they are doing in favor of their own national economies, and we should be less self-suicidal in Europe in the future.
Our time is almost up, and I know that you have a very tough schedule. But I have one question for the to close this series. I mean, I'm sure that we are going to have the opportunity and the reason to talk to each other in the coming year. Critics, I would rather say admirers, say that you have started your journey back from the moon regarding mileage. That is the amount of kilometers you have traveled. You know, the distance of the moon is quite substantial, 384,000 kilometers.
All right.
But putting apart the joke, we do have a space program, which is also being supervised by you.
Yeah, I made the test.
Maybe a couple of sentences about that.
Well, you know, I mean, traveling so much would be really suspicious if you talk to the Minister of Interior now. So, but I mean, if you are a foreign minister, it's kind of in the name, so foreign, meaning you have to deal with other parts of the world without going there or without inviting them here. It's very complicated. And you know, what I think we have learned from COVID, that there's no alternative for the personal presence and the personal discussion. I mean, you all know that. So when it comes to our space program, yeah, I mean, it might. It might sound strange, but actually, during the communism, from where we have collected just very limited positive experience, and when I say very limited, less than five fingers would be enough to count them all. But one is definitely the fact that in this artificial sharing of labor, for some reason, we got some duties for space industry, and that's why we have a heritage, we have a capacity.
But Hungary performed very well,
yeah,
as a matter of fact.
Right. So we have a capacity and a heritage based on this former decision in the framework of Comecon. And we have to utilize on that. And we have many Hungarian companies who are successfully being part of big international projects for satellites and other scientific experiments. And we keep on supporting these Hungarian companies. And it was our colleagues who suggested, and then first it seemed to be a little bit too ambitious, but now I understand it was a good decision to run a new national astronaut program. It's just a bit more than 40 years ago that our only so far astronaut was out in the space, who happens to be an employee in this ministry. And now it's time for another Hungarian astronaut to fly to the space. But it's not about tourism. The space gives chance to carry out experiments and tests of solutions and applications which might be drivers of future economic growth. So now working groups on the universities and in many Hungarian companies are working on those projects, which will be tested and experimented by and with in the space by the Hungarian astronaut who would spend out there a couple weeks on the International Space Station. Now we have a cooperation with the Americans, a company called Axiom, together with which we will fly our astronaut. There was several hundreds of applicants there. We have narrowed down the roster to 8. The Air Force is testing them currently, and there will be 4.
So those who can survive.
Yeah, there will be 4.
Probably are going to be entitled to go.
There will be 4 who will be entirely trained, and then at the end there can be only 1, as we know it. So there will be 1 at the end who will fly. It's going to be decided very, very closely before the flight itself.
Very well. Péter Szijjártó, Minister of Foreign Affairs and Trade, thank you for the discussion and much appreciate. You can sense that there's still a lot to talk about. That gives us the opportunity to continue in our next season in 23. Please stay tuned for the Bold Truth About Hungary. Keep in mind that we always say what we mean and we always mean what we say. Thank you.